All right, boys, welcome back to another video. Knicks Daily here. Today we're going to be talking about Julius Randle. There hasn't been any news on the team for the first time in a while. There's always been some sort of report or rumor. But today, let's just talk about the latest Randle news. So Ian Begley reported that some decision makers within the Knicks aren't bullish on Randle's fit with the group anymore. It makes for a somewhat awkward fit for Randle, a traditional power forward who thrives with the ball in his hands and is neither an elite shooter or defender. To be honest, it makes sense why some people would think this, but at the same time, the Knicks went 12-2 in January with Ananobi and Randle in the lineup. So why exactly would the Knicks trade Randle, who's coming off of a surgery, who's coming off of the best play of his career? You look at the first six games of the season, Randle averaged 14 on 27% shooting, 23 from three, a 37 true shooting, terrible. His last 40 games of the season, it's 26 points on 50% shooting, 33 from three, 59% true shooting. Randle was absolutely dominating. There's going to be times next season, and specifically in the playoffs, where Randle is the best player on the court, the best player in an entire seven-game series. Most importantly, against Boston, it's hard to find a player lately that's cooked the Celtics like Randle. His bully ball is going to be crucial for the Knicks, not to mention that Brunson's going to get more time off of the ball, which means he's going to last longer in the season and be at his best, and he's going to get more catch-and-shoot opportunities, which is still off the ball. But wouldn't it be nice to see Brunson get a couple, even if it's just two or three open threes off of a Randle double team? I mean, I know it doesn't make sense to leave Brunson open, but Randle, you're not letting him go one-on-one, right? Teams are not going to do that because they're going to lose every single time. I mean, Randle, I don't want to say he reminds me of Melo the way they played, but it's just the post game and the physicality reminds me of Melo. I mean, Melo's one of the most physical players in NBA history. Randle's pretty much the same. I mean, he's going to go at you and he's going to get his. I don't know why we would trade Randle. There's just no upside to it. I would get if we traded Randle for another superstar, right, and swap them out, but it's not going to be the case. We would have to probably do Randle, maybe Mitch or Randle and McBride, and then add draft picks. There's just no way I'm doing that because, again, Randle's a three-time All-Star, a two-time All-NBA player, and he was the first player on the Knicks that got us up and running. Brunson, Mikal Bridges, OG, you know, Mitch Robinson, yeah, all these guys are great, but Randle was the first player who sort of came here and took on the responsibility of what it's like to play in New York in a Madison Square Garden and all of the pressure. So I definitely don't want to look to move him right now. I know I have made videos expressing my thoughts on Randle and hasn't all been positive. I don't think he's a perfect player, but the Knicks are not winning a championship without him because you can't have Mikal Bridges as your second option today. I mean, you look at the Celtics, they've got Tatum, they've got Brown, they've got Derek White, they've got Porzingis. In order to beat them, we need Randle. There's just no question about it. And defensively, we don't need Randle to do too much because, again, we've got Mitch, Bridges, and OG. As long as those guys stay healthy, it's about as elite as it gets, right? I mean, Mitch is going to average 2 to 3 blocks a night. And then Bridges and OG is the best perimeter defensive duo in the league. Brunson's an above-average defender. I don't know why so many Knicks fans say he's a bad defender. It's pretty clear who watches the games and who doesn't. Jalen Brunson is not an elite defender, but he puts in effort and he takes charges and he gets after you. He's got pretty good hands, whether it's stripping the ball or getting into the passing lane. He's just a smart player. Like, Brunson's not a bad defender. And if you guys listen to his podcast, him and Josh Hart, man, it's hilarious, some of the things he says. He acts like he's the best defender in the league. And it's just, I love it, man. Go check it out. But overall, yeah, looking at our bench, this is something that I'm super excited about. I don't talk about it too much because it's the bench, but it has me just as excited. I mean, I can't wait to see what Devo does next season. Miles McBride, Josh Hart, Jericho Sims, I don't think he's going to be our backup center, but to this point, he might be because it doesn't seem like we're signing anyone anytime soon. We went out and we got Campaign before our backup center. Speaking of Campaign, he's going to be a big part of our second unit. Tyler Kolek's the guy who the Knicks feel is NBA ready. I've been watching clips of him in the gym, and of course, he played in the summer league. He just has a natural act for the game of basketball. He's certainly going to play some sort of role for the Knicks. It might not be right away. I did see a report that Tyler Kolek is the backup point guard right now over Cameron Payne, but also Ian Begley reported that Payne is going to have a big role for our second unit. So how does that make sense if Kolek's the backup, but Payne is going to have a big role? I'm super confused. Like, it's just kind of contradicting each other. So we'll have to wait and see till it happens at this point because I've heard both. And then really outside of that, I guess we're looking at Keita Bates, yeah, I don't think is going to be a part of our rotation. He has the potential to be if he plays well in camp. And Huck Porty's a guy that I know a lot of Knicks fans like. He's on a two-way. We'll see. And we talked about Dimitrios Skopencev yesterday and how I feel like he deserves a chance. The issue is, though, we've got a Porty and a two-way, and Jericho Sims, they picked up his contract, his team option. So I don't know how that's going to happen. There's just not a lot of wiggle room right now in this rotation. We only have one more roster spot, to be honest with you guys, and that's the backup center. Technically, too, we need a backup center, and then we also could use another wing, a Gordon Hayward type of player, somebody that could fill in if there's an injury, someone who doesn't really need to do too much, but just kind of there for emergency purposes that can stay ready. Our rotation, it's going to be Brunson, Bridges, OG, Randle, Mitchell Robinson, and then our one is going to be Tyler Kolek, because Cameron Payne is not really a point guard, or at least he's not a true point guard. So that's why I'm going with Kolek. And then at the two, I'll put Campaign. But then what about McBride, though? See, that's what I don't understand is, because McBride, it was reported that he's going to be a part of our eight-man rotation. So he's automatically in the first three off of the bench. So, like, I'm going to go with Kolek, McBride, Devo Hart, and then let's just say Precious Achiuwa to that point. We'll go with what we have, Jericho Sims, because we don't have Achiuwa right now. I think he'll end up re-signing because we have his bird rights. But so Kolek, McBride, Debo Hart, Jericho Sims, and then we've got Campaign. Hopefully, again, we get Precious. And then we've got Hiate Bates-Diop, maybe. And then, like, that's where Gordon Hayward could kind of be a role. So we have a much deeper team than last year. We had a deep team last year. But legitimately, Debo's definitely an NBA-level starter. Josh Hart's definitely an NBA-level starter. And then, again, Campaign is the third guard. I mean, it's pretty crazy. I mean, that's just insane, man. Like, Tyler Kolek, I think, is a guy who he's just too good to not get out there. He's sort of like rookie Emmanuel Quickley. He's a guy that, yeah, he's young, he's a rookie, but Coach Tibbs is smart enough to know that he should be out there. We'll wait and see, though. I mean, you got to remember, we got Campaign on vets minimum, so it's not like we're dying to play him. He's on vets minimum. Like, find me a better vets minimum player than Campaign. Like, it's going to be very difficult. I'm sure there are. Like, Gary Trent Jr., you guys might like him more. I mean, it's just a no-brainer. I would have done that, too. Especially injuries. Like, what if Jalen Brunson gets injured? What if he misses 7 to 10 games? Oh, well, now we've got Tyler Kolek and Campaign running the point. I mean, we can certainly win 6 of those 10. We can go 6-4 without Jalen Brunson. Last season, absolutely not. We were atrocious without him on the court. But I think this time around, legitimately, I mean, the Knicks would make the playoffs without Brunson because, again, Randle, he's done it before. He got us all the way up, of course, to a top seed. Remember, man, were we the fourth seed? Feels like so long ago, man. Fourth, fifth seed. We had home court in that, so fourth seed. And then we ended up taking on the Hawks and didn't go great. But I think this is a playoff team without Brunson. It's would lose in the first round, though. With Brunson, championship team, right? So it's pretty cool. Like, the talent around Brunson's playoff level, and then you add yourself in, now you're an NBA contender. So yeah, credit to Leon Rose for how he's constructed this team, to trade for OG, to get rid of RJ and IQ. Like, IQ's making more money than Jalen Brunson. And RJ Barrett was a guy who consistently just didn't play well. And we end up swapping them for OG. We have the number one ranked defense. And he was a huge part of beating Philadelphia. I mean, we were up 2-0. And then he got injured. Remember, he got injured, of course, in that game. But and then, he goes out there, he trades for Mikal Bridges, saves up all this draft capital, trades for Bridges. Dante DiVincenzo gave him a contract. Josh Hart trades for him, extends him. Vets minimum Campaign, drafts Tyler Kolek in the second round. Mitchell Robinson was a second-round draft pick. A lot of people seem to forget that. Miles McBride was a second-round draft pick. Jericho Sims is a guy who was a second-round draft pick, but he hasn't really done too much for us. I mean, I don't want to act like he's trash. I mean, the Knicks were a 500 team when he started, which could be a lot worse. But I'm also excited for Pacome Diadier out of France. He's only 18, but you can tell he just knows how to play the game of basketball. He gets to his spots. He's got an amazing-looking shot. It just didn't go in very often in the summer league. But he makes the right reads, the right shots, the right looks. He's just not making. That's definitely workable, right? A lot of guys can't get to their spots, can't create off the dribble, and aren't able to run within the flow of the offense, aren't able to cut. Diadier does that. Okay, he makes a great move and he misses the shot. Well, he's 18 years old, dude. He'll get there. Ariel Hakporti, I thought, got better during the summer league. He definitely needs to add on weight and muscle. What is he, 22? He's got a great, that left hand hook is deadly. Like he's going to be a big part of the Knicks in a couple of the seasons, but in a couple of seasons he's not going to help us win this year. And then like Tyler Kulak is he's sort of, I would say Randle and Kulak are the biggest question marks. Randle because he is one of the best players in basketball. Can he stay healthy? Can he fit in with his team? Because there's people within the Knicks organization questioning that. Again, yeah, 12-2 in January, so there's a little bit of a sample size, but not a whole season, not a playoff run. And then Tyler Kulak, how does he look at the NBA level? Look great in the summer league, but what about his athleticism? Can he finish over these big, strong, and fast defenders quick, right? I mean, I think he can, because you have to realize that the Knicks don't need Kulak to defend or to be an amazing finisher. Now, I'm not saying he doesn't need to play zero defense, just like have your hands on your hips. Like, no, he's going to have to work hard on defense, or Coach Tibbs would never play him, but they need him to play make and make everyone better, right? Because the Knicks don't have that. Miles McBride and Cameron Payne, how much do they make other people around them better? I mean, defensively, McBride absolutely does, but offensively is what we're looking at here. Tyler Kulak's a pure point guard, and he's a guy that if Brunson again got injured, I would slide him right into the starting lineup and have him just distribute the basketball. Randle would love playing with him. And Randle can be a number one option for the Knicks if Brunson's out. A lot of teams, if they lose their best player, they're in serious trouble. I mean, the Knicks could get away with it and win games, but obviously we go where Brunson goes, and we saw that in the playoffs against Philly. Though he got up to a slow start, but the last, what was it, like four or five games, I mean, Brunson was playing some of the, maybe the best Knicks basketball in playoff history. I mean, the dude was putting up 40 like it was nothing. Unbelievable run. To do that at 6'2 is crazy, too. But Brunson says he's 6'3 because he's like, I play in shoes, I'm 6'3. Again, go check out their podcast, man. But yeah, it's your boy Nick Daly, guys. Peace.